God brings us each year. Welcome to the recorded service at the First Baptist Church, Hingham, on Sunday, October 13, 2024. Our call to worship today is from the Psalm 103, verses 1 through 5, and can be found on the inside of today's bulletin. Those of you who can, please stand. Reading from your bulletin together.
Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who redeems your life from the pit and crowns you with love and compassion, who satisfies your desires with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles.
Praise God.
Pleasing you together in ministry, that we in turn empowered by your love, your grace, and your truth, would be faithful in serving you. Lord,
hear our prayer.
To say that we live in a world that is strange, especially it seems in recent unfolding years, is an understatement. Forgive us that we're surprised by this. We are reminded of the words of Jesus, that as he left his disciples and promised to come back, that he told them there would be wars and rumors of wars, that there would be sickness, that there would be natural disasters. He warned them so that when these events happen, they would not lose heart and would not lose hope. Lord, strengthen us. And in this moment, at this time, restore hope because of your faithfulness in the midst of trials and tribulations. Lord,
hear our prayer.
And as we pray for hope for ourselves, as we give thanks for the blessings that each one of us has experienced and the blessing of being gathered on this morning, we do pray for your continued justice, empowerment of those who serve others, and ultimately your ability to shine the light of truth, especially in the midst of darkness. And so we pray your presence for the leadership of our nation and the anticipated transition of leadership within our nation. We pray for your presence, especially for the leadership of Israel, of Ukraine. We pray that these countries would seek truth and light, and that they would truly seek peace in any avenue of peace, and that they would remember the high standard of not only loving their neighbors, but even, empowered by truth, to love our enemies. Lord,
hear our prayer.
And gracious God, we praise your name because of the sustaining presence in our lives. We praise your name because as your children, sisters and brothers in Christ, sons and daughters of the living God, that every good gift that we have is given to us by our Father in heaven. And so therefore, as your children, we always want to live in gratitude. Live in gratitude for the sufficiency of your presence. Live in gratitude because of how you, at times, strengthen us in our weaknesses as we turn to you. And so therefore, Lord, we continually praise your name because of the experience of love, mercy, and grace in each one of our lives. Together we
praise God.
And as we offer our praise and our petitions, we continue to pray for those within our extended church family, those who much need your loving presence to strengthen them in the midst of challenges, medical diagnosis, treatment, living in a foreign land. And so we name some of the people that we're mindful of. We can't name them all, but each one of us carries individuals in our hearts. And after I name some names, I will pause. And I'll encourage not only those gathered in the sanctuary this morning, but those who are listening to this recording, to take time to lift up by speaking the name of people that you carry in your heart. We remember Dory. We remember Geoff with his anticipated treatment. We think of those who are traveling, especially internationally now, Kevin and Terry, as they visit their daughter who is living in Colombia to serve. We think of those who continue to serve our nation, The care package ministry is close to the heart of this church, and we are reminded of the soldiers who respond to the call. Whether they are part of soldiers that are in ravaged areas of our country that are called out to help and to restore order and to rescue people, or there are soldiers who are serving because they're deployed internationally. We ask your blessing, we ask your wisdom to rest upon them and not upon the leaders, but we especially remember Nick. We also remember ongoing prayers where we want to be faithful and persistent. We think of Teddy. We think of Tyler. Gracious God, you hear these names. You know each person. Send your grace, your love, your mercy, healing. May your presence be sufficient. But most important, may each person know that you love them and that you are always near. Having heard these names, having shared these names, I now invite each one of us from our hearts, review the names of those people that you want to especially lift up in prayer at this moment.
Andrew George Michael. Bobby.
With thanksgiving for turning your ear to listen to our prayers. Together we
praise God.
United with praise, with petitions, we pray the prayer that you taught your disciples, and together we say,
Our Father,
who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name,
thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day
our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors,
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers come forward, we are reminded continually. Giving gifts is demonstrated by God, who is generous and in abundance continually. Giving gifts is our way of saying thank you and empowering the ministry of this church and its mission both here and around the world. We all have different resources. May we give from our hearts joyfully. And whatever we give, that we know pleases God. Amen.
Thank you. Hebrews 4, verses 12 through 16. For the word of God is living and effective and sharper than any double-edged sword, penetrating as far as the separation of soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. No creature is hidden from him, but all things are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has been tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. Therefore, let us approach the throne of his grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in the time of need.
Amen. Praise the Lord. The Brodericks are taking over today. Praise God. We are so thankful to be here today. And I really give thanks to God that he's brought me through this ordeal and myself as well. God is good. And prayer works. Amen. Prayer works. I don't have any funny stories, but I don't know. Some people come to church to hear me speak so they can hear the joke. So I'll just mention one that I was mentioning earlier. You know, the three ladies that were walking up the hill, and they were all hard of hearing. And Mary said, "Boy, it sure is windy up here." And then the one in the middle said, "It's not Wednesday, it's Thursday." And the one on the far end said, "I'm thirsty too, let's go get a beer." Amen. But God wants us to listen to his word and spend time in his word and realize that his word really is alive. His word is active and powerful. And today I want to do a little something different, but first let's pray. Father, I ask that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart will be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer, whom we love and we adore and we cherish, and we ask you to make your word clear to us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to spend a little time in an introduction. Because the book of Hebrews was written for Jewish readers, okay? It was written with Jewish people in mind. And there's a correlation between the book of Hebrews and the book of Leviticus in the Old Testament. And most of us have nothing to do with Leviticus. Can I get a witness? Leviticus is a tough read. We do very well when we start Genesis. Oh, I'm going to read the Bible. And we start to read Genesis, and that seems to go really well. And then we read the book of Exodus, when Moses leads the Hebrew children out of Egypt. And that goes very well. Then we get into Leviticus, and all these sacrifices, and this and that. And it's full of different customs. Let me give you a few. There are burnt offerings in the book of Leviticus. There's customs of the grain offerings, offering grain. There's also offering goats for the fellowship offerings. This is Leviticus, a bull for the sin offering. And the blood has to be sprinkled in a certain way throughout the book of Leviticus. There's the guilt offering. There's the offering of the first fruits. In chapter 23. And there were so many different rules that the priest had to follow and to teach the people. They had to be careful of certain foods that they could eat. There were certain foods that they could not eat. Amen. And they had to remember that there were certain holy days. There was Yom Kippur. Jewish people even today are celebrating Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement, when you confess your sins before God and you confess your sins toward one another. If you've offended somebody, you go to that person and say, I just want you to know I'm sorry. So these are very important in Jewish religion. And the writer of Hebrews knew it. And he incorporates those concepts in what he's writing. There are also laws of if you didn't obey the law, you were getting punished. But all of it, to sum it up, is a shadow of Jesus Christ. Let me say that again. All of this book of Leviticus, it's a foreshadowing of Jesus. If you look at somebody's shadow, that doesn't tell you what they look like exactly. It sort of gives you certain proportions. But it gives you something, but it doesn't give you the whole clear view of what that person may look like. What it does is it gives a shadow of who Jesus is and Jesus was going to become once he came to life and became a man as the Son of God. We look at this other part of the shadow in the sacrificial lamb that was sacrificed. And that was a representation of Jesus. When the lamb was slaughtered and sacrificed to God, we do this at communion every first Sunday. We remember the atoning sacrifice that Jesus made of himself. And that's what Leviticus is also hinting at. Years and years and years and years before Jesus became a man on this earth. And we celebrate communion, the bread and the wine or the juice, which is a representation of the broken body of Christ for our redemption to God, and the shed blood of Christ, which is also to cleanse us from all of our sins. His word is alive. There's life in this word. There's power in this word. But it costs something. And I want you to understand, this wasn't something easy for Jesus to do. It cost him his life. And he gave of himself willingly because he loves each of us. That's amazing. All of us, he loves us. There's nothing you can do to get him not to love you because he loves you that much. His love is always there. He said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. The writer of Hebrews knows this is a foreshadowing of who Jesus would become. And he's reaching out to the Jews. We think that it might be Jewish people that were in Italy. We don't know who the writer of Hebrews was. There's no clue. Some people said it was the Apostle Paul. You know, some of the old King James Version Bibles will say that Paul was the writer of Hebrews. It was sure guesswork. They didn't know. They just put that in. But scholarship has suggested that, first of all, we know that the book of Hebrews had to have been written before 70 AD when the temple was destroyed. We know that. And we know that it was most likely written after Paul had been executed, which was around 67 AD. So it was somewhere in there. And we don't know who wrote it, but we have a sense that it was written to people in the churches of Rome. And there's some other things that we need to remember, too. One clue is that at the very end of the letter of Hebrews, it says, and greet the people of Italy greet you. It says, everyone from Italy sends their greetings. But the whole premise of Hebrews was written because Jewish people, at that time, they were at a crossroads. They were at a crossroads because some of them were being persecuted. Some of them were having their property destroyed. Some of them were put in prison. We know at the end of Hebrews, Timothy was mentioned. Timothy just came out of jail. We're celebrating at the very end of Hebrews. It says, rejoice because Timothy has just been released. So there was a lot of persecution. And one of the reasons that Hebrews was written was to get a message to the Jews who were starting to turn away, from Christianity. And what they were doing was, it was acceptable to go to the Jewish synagogues, but Christianity was illegal in that time. Nero, the emperor, had made it illegal. So if you were Christian, you could be jailed, you could be executed. Can you imagine that? And so some of the Jews were kind of trying to straddle the fence. They figured, well, the temple is okay. We're not going to be ostracized here. But the problem was that if you went back to the synagogue, if you went back to the temple leaders wanted you to renounce Christianity. We'll let you come. You can worship God. But get rid of that Jesus stuff. You don't want to have anything. And they had to like sign a confession that they didn't believe. And some of them did. They still believed in the Lord, but they did it publicly so that they could get into the temple and worship and not be ostracized. Some of them had their property stolen from them because they claimed to believe in Christ. Some of them were beaten up. Some of them were jailed, as I said. And so they were afraid. So the writer of Hebrews is essentially writing this whole book to say there is a better way. This word is truth. This word is alive. This word is powerful. And this word, even if you are afraid of being ostracized, this word can give you power to overcome anything. And that's what the writer of Hebrews was doing. It was Martin Luther King that said, we must accept finite disappointment, but we must never lose infinite hope. Robert Frost said, hope is not found in a way out, but in a way through. And Helen Keller once wrote, a happy life consists not in the absence, but in the mastery of hardships. Mastering those hardships. Upon every life some rain will fall. And some of us as Christians, we get afraid of the peer pressure that we encounter. Some of us, if we were Christians as young people in college or grad school or whatever, people would make fun of us and say, you believe that stuff really? You really believe? You know, and we get tense. We don't want to be, you know, stick out like a sore thumb. Jesus said, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you when you come to my kingdom. It's not always easy serving God. And the people who were Jewish were struggling because some of them, they really did believe in Christ, but they were afraid to proclaim it publicly because they were afraid of being ostracized. How many of you have ever been pressured, peer pressure? People trying to get you to think this way, and you don't believe that, and you believe this, or whatever. We've all been through it. And it's not fun, it's not easy. Hudson Taylor once wrote, God is not looking for men of great faith. He is looking for common people to trust in his great faithfulness. We don't have to be great. All we have to do is trust in him. Trust and obey. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. So that's kind of my introduction this morning. I wanted you to understand something about the book of Leviticus. The sin offerings, the guilt offerings, the celebration of the first fruits, all of that was a foreshadowing of Jesus. What he was going to do when he gave his life as an offering for our sins. The Bible is not some kind of esoteric, mysterious, secret kind of manuscript to discourage you. God's word is acceptable, is accessible to anybody who wants to truly and sincerely grow closer to God. Let me say that again. God's word, this holy word, is accessible to anyone who truly wants to find God. If you want God, you can find him. He says, draw near to me and I will draw near to you. Draw near to me, I will draw near to you. And my prayer and hope and desire is that we would develop a hunger and a thirst and an objective for learning more and more and more, as much as we can, about the precious word of God. Amen. I'm not done. The power of the word of God. There's power in his word. He can change our lives. Sometimes the Bible can be very uncomfortable. It exposes us what's really on the inside. But the purpose of the Bible is to introduce us to the author, who's God Almighty, our Heavenly Father, and his Son, Jesus Christ, and to develop a relation with him, as well as his Son and his Holy Spirit. So let's look at this passage of Hebrews. The three qualities, three features that the writer talks about. First, the word of God is living. The word is alive. The Greek word is zeo, which means that it has life within it. There is life within the word itself. It is living, it's breathing in a spiritual sense. The word of God is alive. You can speak the word of God, and there's power that goes out because you've claimed it. I told you all this story years ago. My grandmother, God rest her soul, born in the 1800s. She was walking around 1912. She was a young lady then. And somebody tried to mug her and grab her pocketbook, and she just claimed the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. And the guy was running and running and running and running. Boom! All of a sudden, he ran. It was like an invisible wall. Ran into the wall, fell down. He turned around and looked at my grandmother, threw the pocketbook at her, and ran away. You know, there's power in this word. And my grandmother used to tell me that story for years and years and years. And it didn't make any sense until I got much older and I realized there's power in the word of God. Amen. And we need to claim that power. I know some of you, I won't mention your names, but I know some of the stories where you've claimed certain passages of scripture for people who were sick and prayed for them and God did something. There's power in the word, but we've got to do something with it. It's alive. That's my message today. The word is alive. Secondly, the word is powerful. The Greek word is energes. We get the word energy. It's energetic. It's effective. It's efficacious. That means it produces positive, successful results. It's powerful. The word of God is energy for our lives. When we feel down, get some of the word, read, study, read the word of God. And there are passages that, you know, you can even go on Google and find, what do I need to read for this? What do I need to read for that? Google will even tell you what to read. It's crazy. But the word of God is powerful. If you choose to follow the word will follow you. Amen. And thirdly, it's sharper than a two-edged sword. It uses the word sword, but the real meaning is that it is really sharp as a surgeon's scalpel. And I've never seen a scalpel, so I don't know how sharp it is, but it's a lot sharper than a two-edged sword. It's sharp. And it cuts open, it divides. The word of God divides the light from the darkness. The word of God divides the bad from the good. The word of God divides the bone from the marrow, the book of Hebrews says, and it divides the truth from the untruth or lies. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness by the devil, Jesus consistently quoted scripture. It is not good for man to man doesn't live by bread alone. Thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. All those came from the book of Deuteronomy when Jesus was being confronted by the devil. And the Bible says in Psalm 19, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. There's power in his word, and that word is sharp and it cuts. And what's the relevance to us? Because if we read the word, it can separate, listen to me, it can separate that temptation that we were maybe going to do, and it gets us to focus on the will of God that he wants us to do. Instead of losing my temper on Route 128 at so-and-so because they did whatever, the Lord will give me a sense of forgiveness for that person that cut me off or whatever they did, and just pray for them and just continue to go on my way and have peace of mind. The Bible says that every word of God is flawless. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away. The word of God. Psalm 138 says, he is exalted above all things, his name and his word. Now, I don't know about you, but that's a powerful statement. He is exalted above all things, his name and his word. Don't forget that after he was crucified and died, and they thought, okay, Jesus, it's over now. We don't have to worry about anything. He rose again on the third day, and he ascended unto the Father. And from there, he will judge. He will come back and judge the living and the dead. Jesus is real. His word is powerful. And he is coming back one day. And one day, we're all going to see him. Now, the question is, will we see him with a smile, or will we see him like being petrified? We determine that right now, if we love him, if we love his word. The word is, in this instance in Hebrews, is the word logos. That's a Greek word that has to do with the inspired word of God. Logos, in certain instances in the Bible, refer to Jesus Christ. But in this particular passage in Hebrews, it has to do with the inspired word of God. And what the word, another comparison of the word is used as, what we said, sharp as a two-edged sword. But in some, in Jeremiah chapter 23, it's also compared, the word of God is compared to a fire. It's compared to a fire that refines and a hammer that breaks the hard places of our hearts. That's the power of the word of God. And in Ephesians chapter 5, it's referred to as water, washing the impurities of our hearts. And in 1 Peter, the second chapter, the word of God is referred to as spiritual milk that nourishes us and to help us grow. Did you get that? Spiritual milk that nourishes us and helps us to grow. So I'm going to end with a couple of points. The word of God, please remember this, is not just a lie, but the word of God breathes God's life into us. Think about that for a minute. When we talk about being born again, what did Jesus do? Remember in that passage in the New Testament, he breathed on the disciples and they received the Holy Spirit. There's a power that each of us has in Christ Because we have surrendered we have died to self. It's not about us, it's about him. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these other things will be added unto you. The word breathes God's life into us. That's my first one. Second point and takeaway is the word of God will strengthen our faith, because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? The word of God. Thank you.
Hey, time.
And the third takeaway is that the word of God will give each one of us a power to overcome the enemy's obstacles. We're living in a time where obstacles are, there's just a plethora of obstacles. You want to try to do this, you've got to go through this, and you've got to go through that. There's so much hatred in the world today. There's so much war. You know, I've lived in so many different countries growing up as a kid, and it's such a burden to think. You know, living in Africa, and we would go to church as little kids, and people really love to worship the Lord. And a lot of these African countries, I mean, you stop and think about Sudan and everything that's going on over there. I mean, everywhere. You could name any country on any continent. There's so much conflict and so much tension. And God wants to use each of us to be a light, to make a difference in someone else's lives, so that they can see, they can have an opportunity to get closer to God. Let me finish this. Summarize, the word of God will bring life, amen? The word of God will strengthen our faith if we choose to read it and spend some time. And thirdly, the word of God will give us the power to overcome all the obstacles of our journey in this life. God loves you. God loves each one of you in a magnificent way. That's why I love some of the other Psalms, Psalm 145, Psalm 146, and 147. I will praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord forever and ever. I will give thanks to God. I will thank him and praise him. Why? Because his love endureth forever. He's with you, even when you're not feeling good. Even when you know you've got some pains in the body. God's with us and he loves us. And he hasn't abandoned anyone in this room or watching or whatever. He loves us and he cares about each one. And all he asks is that we would trust him and obey him. Amen.
Thank you.
understandings, not only guard our hearts in the midst of challenges, but also would make us whole because we receive the living Word of God within us and follow you.